That's a little early for the next thing, but they started ringing the bell a little early, and it looked like most people came back in, and Aashish said he could use the extra 7 minutes. So we'll go ahead and start, and I guess maybe anyone out there can come in. So next up is Aashish Sharma, who has been using Bro longer than me. you probably started using Bro in 2003, 2004, something like that. Sorry, Zeke, that's going to take a while to change. but yeah, he's been using Bro for a long time at the National Center for Supercomputing Applications and at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, and has just been all over the place doing all sorts of stuff. And I am super excited now that he's talking about how to write Bro scripts, because it's clearly a very important part of, sorry, Zeek scripts. It's a very important part of Zeek. Yeah, so the ceiling tech guys, you gave the last Bro presentation ever. So anyway, I'll go ahead and get out of the way and let Aashish get started.
I put the wrong slide deck. Should have been. I am Aashish Sharma. I work for Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. I run Bro there. Though I have been running Bro for a while, I still think I am very new to Bro. Because it's vast, it's immense, there is so many surprises all the time, it's just like, the limits are endless. I have given a bunch of talks in BroCon before, pretty complicated topics, very advanced topics, very clumsy topics like scan detection, internal clusterization, or incident response with Bro or SMTP. So this year I actually thought, let's go back to basics, and given that we have a new intrusion detection system, let's start with 101 scripting. And I think I have this privilege of being the first Zeek speaker now. So so here's a question. How many people here have written a Bro script? Quite a bit. How many people here have written more than 5 Bro scripts? Good. So there is still a good audience here. How many people have written Bro package, want to write a Bro package? So here's the deal. I actually said, okay, this is a pretty cool talk to give, like Bro scripts 101. And 595 is because back in the grad school, 595 was the independent study. And I was hoping, like, you know, by end of my talk, everybody's going to be so good that they're going to be on their own doing it. I did not know what I signed up for. This is difficult. So I'm from Berkeley Lab. Berkeley Lab is known for doing science, some cool stuff. We have 13 Nobel Prize winners. What you get winning a Nobel Prize in the lab is a guaranteed parking spot, so that's the incentive. I am more fascinated by Berkeley Lab because of some history there. Cuckoo's Egg, first documented hacking story, very fascinating. We still have a rack which actually used to host those servers, which got compromised. All the TCP dump tools, Craig is one of the original authors of TCP dump. He is in my in the team I work with. So that's a pretty good thing. Birthplace of Bro, very proud about it. Now Zeek. So in this talk, I wanted to attempt actually going into Bro scripting. Everybody has a different way of learning things. There is a lot of documentation, lot of material available online, including like if you go to previous Bro conferences, there are scripting tutorials which are very elementary, starts from scratch, everything. So there was no point reinventing that wheel, like just showing you everything which is available on web or YouTube talks. So this was more of like, okay, my experience of what to do, what not to do. I sometimes make spectacular mistakes, like it takes like lot of people to figure out, okay, what the heck did I do wrong? And turns out it was such subtle things. And I was like, I have a list of all those, and I wanted to bring those up. But turns out, to talk about that is like 595, and you cannot cover that in 15 minutes. But there is a lot of do's and don'ts and experiences. But I still wanted to make this talk simple, elementary, to, as a starting point. Like all programming languages, there is a hello world. Bro has a simple hello world. So the way Bro scripting model works is actually it's an event-driven programming language. There is an event which actually either calls a function, calls an event. Events could be various things. For example, you have a new connection. That would trigger an event, new connection, if you have a connection established. So there are all these different events on the TCP states. Then there are events on protocols. For example, HTTP GET request has an event. There is an IRC connection, that would be an event. FTP, that would be an event. So there are all these different events. But one of the events which starts at the very beginning is Bro init. And actually, if you do this, Bro init would work. So how do you run this? Not sure how many people are familiar with it, but there is a try.bro.org. So if you go, you paste this and run, there is an output at the bottom, which literally would give you like how to run the Bro script. I'm sorry for people at the back, like at the very bottom is not seen. I try to keep other slides at a little higher level. But here is this thing. Now, how do you run it on the shell? Basically, you say Bro, and then you pass this script, and that would generate an output. So these are two different ways. I generally go with the command prompt, but try.bro is good, and here is why it is really good. It has like all these built-in tutorials right available there. So if you select one of these points, like for example, basics of variable, there is a tutorial available, and then you can just play, test, try, run, and do things. And the list keeps going on. It like goes to like logging framework, input framework. It is pretty comprehensive and exhaustive. So I think the best I could do is not reinvent the wheel, but just put a pitch here. So going back to this thing where it's like, OK, yeah, I have an event, Bro in it. It says hello world. Then there is another event when Bro is completely finished doing what it's doing. There is an event called Bro done, which actually kicks in. But a lot of Bro scripting documentation is available here. I actually took a screenshot. I wanted to say, how this is comprehensive. It took like 2 minutes for my laptop to actually get this screenshot done, and then it's like, okay, here. But yeah, if you go to this resource, it's a very good resource to starts from very elementary, goes through all the little finite details, and then it keeps going up all to the very end is like, okay, input framework, logging framework, all this stuff. There are plenty of blogs available which talk explicitly about different frameworks too. So why Bro scripting? Like when I started using Bro, I was actually a security engineer, not a Bro engineer. I needed a tool to do my job. Bro was that tool. And here are some data types which Bro has. So usual stuff, Boolean, count, integer, double. But what makes it kind of unique, for me at least, is these network types. There's a port, address, subnet. These are built in. Bro understands that this is an address, this is a subnet, this is a port. You can also say things like, okay, is 22 TCP greater than 5000? If not, take this action. Like well-known ports, 1024. So you're like, okay, I want action on everything which is less than well-known ports, but not on more than well-known. So you can write all these different heuristics. Then there are all these like workhorses, like container types. For example, tables, sets, vectors, records. These are pretty important tools inside Bro scripting world, and I actually severely rely on a bunch of them. And then there are all these different things, like there are functions, events, hooks, and things keep getting complicated, like for example, opaque type, bloom filters, cardinality. But here is the basic stuff. So then, like other programming languages, the variables have scopes. So there are like globals, there are locals, then there is namespace. You create a module goes in its own namespace. That way you can actually do things in your namespace and not fight with the Bro's global namespace or anybody else's package, for example. So then there are constants. I think the constants are now getting better treatment with the configuration framework. So like for example, there is this constant like, okay, default capture password, that's fault. So these are used basically more for configuration files before you start Bro. Like, okay, do you want to capture passwords which go in clear text on HTTP? If you want to do that, put them in the log file, just change that to true. And then you start Bro, it actually goes up. One of the powerful capabilities is redefining an attribute. But the deal with Bro is that you configure these files with attributes. For example, there's a port. So you say port 22 TCP. Then you start Bro, and the Bro would be like, Bro, when Bro runs, it loads your script. It's the script has a variable SSH port. It's set as 22 TCP. Later on, turns out like, oh, no. I see SSH on 443 TCP too. So you can go or 80 TCP or like, for example, I think the variable I was using in my script was like watch destination port. And all of a sudden, so you have this set of ports. You define them. Now you want to add something more. You can extend this particular variable. Similarly, there are subnets, patterns, addresses. So the redefined variable helps in static version of Bro, where you have configuration file, you go, you add an append to a particular variable. For example, I was watching VPN subnet. So the VPN subnet is defined as this. But if I have a redef, I can actually extend it and put another one there. Or pattern. So like the pattern is like, OK, watch for all the strings which actually have word owned in them, and then like, okay, no, I want something which has hacked in them. So you can actually keep doing that. So like, for example, VPN subnet is defined as this, then you extend it by using plus equals to, and then, but here is the first mistake I made. I was defining, my boss told me like, hey, we need to add this. I'm like, sure boss, here you go. Turns out I actually forgot to put plus, and it was equals to, and that results in like all the previous declarations getting overridden. So don't do stuff like that. And as I said, I make spectacular mistake. This was one of them. So, but here is the thing. You have a watch URI, there is a pattern, then you append to it, and then this is the way you keep extending. And I think these things are now much easier with new configuration framework. So, but patterns actually are very solid aspect of Bro. I think I use patterns extensively in HTTP analysis, and with encrypted internet and more HTTPS, maybe they are less relevant now. But the deal is I would always like to know, like if certain strings are in a URL, and if they are, let's basically trigger an alert. And it used to be a great tool because, you know, bad guys would actually go download and exploit. So like ptracekmod.c. So you just put that as a pattern in HTTP URL. When they do a wget or a curl, the URL is seen by Bro. Bro generates an alert. You know that this machine downloaded this exploit. So, but now the patterns are also used for things like, here is a problem I have. I want to extract all the URLs from the email. So here is a regular expression for a URL. Actually, Seth gave me that. Otherwise, it won't have worked for me. But you take this URL, you put it in the script, you say, extract all the URLs for me. Then this regular expression would go, look at the body of the email, get the data out. Then you say, OK, I am more curious if that URL is actually an IP address and not a domain. Like, so for example, www.google.com/index.html. Instead of that, it's like 1.2.3.4/index.html. I'm only interested in those. Here is another regular. So you use patterns for things like this too. And I think with 2.6, there are new features coming, which actually is like Bro is constantly evolving. I actually really like these additions because they make life simpler now. For example, the case insensitive thing. I used to create these regular expressions where it would be like capital A and small a, then there is like capital S and then small s and then capital H and small. And now it's like, so I would always have a typo because you are like caps lock, take it off shift. And so it used to be hell typing that. But this makes life elegant, easier, and better. Likewise, like, other operators, so there are these new features coming in. So, but let's go into container types, the real workhorses of Bro scripting. So the idea here for me is to make you guys familiar with these data structures, and the angle I am using is not how you would, like from the syntax point of view, it's more from the use case point of view. And that way I can probably try to convince people like, oh yeah, I should be able to use a table because this is my situation, or I should be able to use record for certain conditions. So like Bro has these four container types, like there is a set which actually is used to store unique elements, table which is a key value pair, like for in Python, it's like almost equal to dictionaries. Vectors, associative arrays, records are like C struct data type where you can create a structure. So here are certain examples of the sets I have been using. So for example, there is a set called never drop net. So we drop a whole lot of IP addresses. We have talked about it. So you create this set of never drop nets and you put all these different address space in that set, and then you can keep growing it over a period of time. So Bro looks at the set membership and then takes an action or not. Same thing is like allocated networks, dark nets. So we actually have a mechanism where networking group publishes a list of all the allocated networks. We feed that into Bro with input framework. Bro actually looks at allocated network and derives unallocated network list, and that unallocated network list becomes our darknet space. So there is a bunch of stuff like this you can do with sets. Ignore source port. If you have border blocked source like ports, then you can create those block ports. So there are sets you can create for name servers, mail servers. You can go and define, or like basically use this as a tool to characterize your network. You like, oh yeah, here are my institutional services. There is a set of institutional services. So, and inside scripting, sets are also used as temporary cache. Like for example, here are potential bot clients. So you put them in that, and then you run more heuristics, then you decide if they still remain potential candidates, or you can remove them from the set. So, but what good they are? So they are good for membership test. Here is some examples. So for like you declare a set, like a set which is a set of addresses, and then there is this bunch of IP addresses in there. And then you literally say, if this IP is in the set, yes, it is in the set, and you get an answer. So, but similarly, you can do is like a set of addresses, set of strings, set of ports, set of subnets. A set of subnets is what I use to derive darknet address space. So there is stuff. But okay, what don't count on sets for preserving state or order. So for example, like if you have all this membership in the set, every time you run Bro to print the members of the set, it's going to give output in a different order, because set does not preserve an order. And actually, the problem I came across was that I was working on authentication framework. I was like, okay, Aashish logged from machine A to B, now went from machine B to C, and then from C to D. Let's put all this in set. And turns out like the output would come and it would confuse everybody. It's like, okay, because sometimes it shows that Aashish logged in from B to A and then to D and then so on and so forth. So it don't count on preserving order, just count on membership test. That works very well. But what helps in preserving order? Vectors. So, and that is one of the reasons Bro is really good and I got attracted to it is, like you see a problem, most likely the Bro developers have already addressed the issue and tried to solve it. It's just that you don't know about it. So I did not quite know about vectors until I had to know about vectors. But it does preserve the order. So you actually have a vector of strings and you can say, okay, 1, 2, 3, it would actually do that. So, but one of the thing I actually use set is on, so one is the membership test, but another thing I actually do is I use set as like how many members are in a set, and this helps me in scan detection too. So let me just briefly get into like a slight background here. So we have darknet space. We derived that based on allocated networks. Now a remote IP connects to our darknet IP addresses. So I said, okay, if a remote IP connects to n number of darknet addresses, I would call that a scanner, and can vary subject to your tolerance. Could be 100, could be 3. depending. So I would keep adding how many different IP addresses this remote IP has tried to connect to. And then I'm like, why should I, like, we have two class B slash 16s. So why should I, like, add all 131,000 IP addresses to it? I am okay with N. So I would just look at the membership, like, how many are there in this particular set? If the set is has, like, 5, 10, or less than equal to N, I keep appending to the set. And then once it crosses the threshold, I say this is a scanner. And if that's a scanner, I stop appending to the set. I purge that particular set. I say, OK, this is a scanner. So sometimes the size operator can help you too. And the size operator is literally putting the set between the two pipes. So this brings me to, like, the next one, and I think I heavily use tables, and it's pretty good. So, like, again, if I start talking about, like, how do you declare table, how do you go through syntax, I'm just copying other people's work. So go to this particular URL, or I think, like, let me Google this for you. So this is basically, if you do bro scripting, first head, go there and search for table, you should be able to see a pretty solid, rock solid, actually, he material on how to get started with table. But like in set, I went into a little depth about, like, showing little code snippets and everything. I am bad at code walking. Like, people get really confused because to write code needs real good understanding, but to explain that needs mastery. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to take a different way. Let's translate security into code. And I think this is generally how I have worked on things. So, like, the question is, basically, we have somebody in our group, Partha, who actually always brings this thing, what problem are you trying to solve? And if you ask that question, things become easier, and you are on the course. So here is the problem. I would like to track how many connections does this IP address make. It's a problem I think is reasonable, I should do it. So that's where you start using data structures like table. You call them scanner. That's a table of an address of count. So it starts making sense, like, yeah, I have an IP address, how many times it has made connections, so it's a count. Now, there are fuzzy subtleties here. For example, did this IP address make N connections to one single machine, or N connections to M machines, or N connections to N machines? So we have to get into more intricacies, but this is a very simple scan detection. Don't use it, though. But so it actually says, like, table address of count, and then you start defining certain characteristics to it. Like, default is zero. So every time you add a new address to it, the default count is zero. Then you can create, you can do certain things with the table. For example, you can create expiration. So you can create three different types of expirations. You can have a create expire, read expire, write expire. So I said, okay, I want to track them for a day. And once something expires from a table, it actually fires up an expire function. So you actually have that too. So this is how you would kind of define a table. And then you start tapping into different events. So like, for example, in this case, I want to tap into event new connection. Now, if you want to just track how many addresses this particular IP has connected to, but port HTTP. Maybe you can actually tap in new connection and look at and filter it on port equals to 80 TCP. But that still gives you a little problem because, you know, HTTP can run on 8080, on 443, can run on all these things. And Bro has DPD, which actually tells you. So maybe instead of tapping in new connection event, you go and you tap in HTTP get request event. So that's how you start defining things. But here is another, let's translate code security into code. Like, how many times have these two hosts talked to each other in last 1 hour? That's a question I would like to answer. So you just extend the table, pretty much same table. So instead of, like, now you want to talk about host pair, so you say table address of count. And now first one could be source or origin address, and the next index value could be a response address, and then here you go, and this should actually get you a communication pattern between, like, counts between two different hosts. Same thing, you can add, tap into different events of your choice. It can be a connection event, it can be a connection, new connection, it can be a connection established. The difference there is that these connection events actually get triggered based on TCP state machine. So you only care about communication where there is established connection, then you actually go in connection established. You want to care about everything, like just send packets going in, maybe a connection attempt is a good event to tap into. A data structure to hold the values which you want, and then an event which actually is relevant to your task. That is the point I would like to convey. So here is another one. Can we build a list of all the services on all the hosts across the network? So remember this line where it's like, know your network? So how do I know what services are running in your network? So there's like, oh yeah, I run nmap, I write email to everybody, and I approve, like, okay, you can run this service, you cannot run, and I keep that list updated. Or you can just run bro and let bro decide it for you. So how do you do that? Like, okay, I have a table address of set port. So recall the set data structure is a membership test. So in this case, I want to know if the services are actually running, and I can know that because a remote IP, so let's say you have a web server in your network, it's running on port 80. Somebody connects to that web server. That connection is going to create an event connection establish. So now you know that there is a full TCP handshake, there is a connection established. We received the connection, we are actually the host here. So basically in connection establish, you go, you say, okay, what's the response IP? Is that in the local address? No, it's not. I don't care if it is a local address, then basically I add that particular connection identifier to my function, which actually goes, distills everything, and then builds this list of, basically populates this table, which is like, okay, 1.1.1.1 actually accepted a connection on port 80 TCP. Now there is a port 22 there. Now, so you actually will have 1.1.1.1 accepted connection on 80 TCP and 22 TCP. So that way it keeps building the list. So you run bro for 6 hours, all of a sudden you have this particular table with all the services which actually have accepted a connection inside your network. You can dump that into a log, and now you actually know what's running on your network. So this is how, where you would use table. This is where you would actually really benefit from that. So here is another one question, like, can we track recent exploit attempts by a given host? And now this gets fuzzy. What is an attempt? I don't know. So you actually define this particular data type. You define what an attempt is, and you go, and then you can create a table address of set attempt. So I just actually kind of focus more on address, but you know, you can actually have a table string of something. You can have a table port of address. You can have a table address of set port, which actually was what one created to detect backscatter in old scan detection. So it gets pretty complicated soon. But this is pretty much about tables. So table is a very powerful functionality. Oh yeah, actually I did put in here. So this is actually a table address of count. So these things work good. Actually, the problem this would create is to initialize. When you are initializing and adding values, you have to be careful how you do it. So you actually initialize the internal table first and then add that to the external table. So there is a way to do things. But tables are useful to store, but then I actually kind of use the expire functions significantly too. And these expire functions help me with a bunch of things. One of the cheat sheets actually Seth told me, and I think Robin hated for Seth to discover that, was that let's say you want to take an immediate action on something which gets added to a table. How do you do that? So Seth goes and does create expire 0 seconds. And as soon as you do that, like something gets added to the table, expire function is gonna run, you actually can do a bunch of operations on it, and then you can return a value which could be 1 hour, 1 day, whatever time you want that value to be in the table. And the expire function can have further logic of how you would expire it eventually. So these are some very powerful functionalities. So going the same model, actually, I came up with one more question. And that was, we maintain a big blacklist, the list of IP addresses we don't like. And that list keeps growing. Even though we are nice people, I think our hatred for bad actors in internet actually just keeps increasing exponentially. So now we have like, what, 1 million, 2 million? I think I counted last time we actually had 10, 11 million IP addresses we didn't like. So, but the deal is, how long do you not like somebody? So either you can decide arbitrarily or you can have bro and you can ask bro this question. So I said, okay, I'm gonna ask bro this question, and by that you have to measure this. So I said, okay, here are a bunch of IP addresses, and when was this IP first seen? When was it actually last seen? How long it has been active for? When was the last connection? And how long it has not been active for since last connection? So this is what I wanted to know. And this is actually, I just filtered on Tor. So this is basically the list of Tor connections which we have. So for example, the last active shows 0 seconds here because there was like one host, two connections here. So it was like boom, boom, and there was nothing there after that. But here there are like 7 hosts, 11 connections. It has been inactive for last 6 hours, roughly 5 hours, 59 minutes. Has been active for 5 days. So the very first connection actually happened 5 days ago. And over 5 days, it actually had connected to 7 hosts with 11 connections. So this is what you do. So like when I have this table, I would actually let bro run for 6 months, go through this table, distill the data, run some awk, set, grep, and I have list of all these IPs which have been probing us regularly versus list of IP addresses which haven't touched us for last 3 months. If they haven't touched us, that's time to revisit and remove them from blacklist maybe. So, but yeah, like, but how do you create this? How do you create this particular log? So you create records, and this is the next data structure which actually is helpful, where you actually go and extend bro scripting language to a new data type. So I actually created this data type called connection stats, and now that's a set, a record, and I said, okay, I care about start time, I care about end time, I care about host, and I care about connection count. So there is opaque of cardinality, don't get confused by it right now. The only thing I would say is that a good substitute here is membership test. What is that? A set. So host was a set of addresses. But the deal is, I don't want to keep same value for each IP. So let's say an IP, remote IP, a Tor node connects to all 131,000 addresses we have. The set will have 131,000 IP addresses. Let's say there are 10,000 Tor nodes. I have 10,000 elements in this particular table with 10,000 sets. Each one of them has exact same value. There is no point. So that's where Johanna and Bro Devs actually came up with other data tools. Like I think the opaque of cardinality is a probabilistic data structure, which actually tells you the counts of how many elements are in this particular structure without having to worry about the memory usage of set. So like if I think I measured at one point of time, as the number of elements increase in a set or table, the memory keeps increasing to like 300 megs, 500 megs, a gig. But if you use opaque of cardinality, you are still having a same counts, approximate same counts because it's a probabilistic data structure, but it runs at like 300 kilobytes. So this helps me with efficiency in memory. But how do you run this? So basically you check if the originator is in the connection table, it's not in the connection table, you initialize this particular record, and then you add that record to the connection table with the index of origin IP. And then you start populating all the times. So this is how I would actually do that. So you create a data structure, you start initializing the data structure, and then you start populating all the fields in there. And over a period of time, these fields get appended. So I have a start time that's pretty static, but the end time is like every time there is an event new connection, it appends and changes the end time to the new end time. So this is how you would actually keep doing it. Here is a slightly more complex record. And This record actually has a timestamp. It has an identifier. It has a, and then I actually looked at this and I'm like, what was I typing? Like, what is hammer spam? And then it's like, no, I was innovative that day. It was ham or spam. So that was the data type I created. But yeah, don't do that. So, but yeah, here is spam status. Default is no spam. Antivirus, like what was the antivirus verdict? What was the delivery status? Who the mail was from, who the mail was to, what was the subject, are there attachments or not? And then you can see that there are certain things like set. So like two, the mail can go to many people, so there is a set of string there. So here's a more complex record. Here is where it is used. So what problem I am trying to solve? So the above one is actually IronPort log. So we get emails from Google to IronPort, and then IronPort manages our email. Bro watches all this stuff. I had bunch of heuristics inside Bro to take action on these emails. And then I realized that I am writing a spam filter. Because like all these things which are getting flagged in my heuristic actually are already flagged by IronPort. But the problem is there was no way for me to know what IronPort is actually saying for a status of a particular email. So I said, I'm going to do something. I'm going to just take, like, first I went to mail admins. I asked them, does IronPort have an API where Bro can talk to them? Like, no. So it's like, okay, IronPort has a log. Let me feed the log back into Bro. So this particular thing is just a log from IronPort. There is an email from support1@dhl.com. IronPort said it's a spam positive. It actually has a virus in it. And I don't care, like it's already detected. I don't want to spend cycles on it. So I take that, I feed that into Bro. It becomes a line inside a Bro log with this particular status that IronPort said spam, it's viral delivery. So the delivery is little fuzzy here because the delivery is to the quarantine folder. So, but this is what I did. So here's this same record, like where it's like, okay, there is this SMTP record, here is this entire data structure. But the things are not simple, they are complex. I did not actually show you the complexities. The complexity is that how do you inject IronPort logs into Bro? You use input framework for that. It's a 3-hour talk probably, but it's amazing. Like you guys need to check input framework. I think it's one of the most favorite framework I have. Then like what about latency? So there is speed of light. Bro watches everything on the wire. So there is an email which goes on wire, then goes to IronPort. Bro actually already knows it before IronPort, maybe nanoseconds, but Bro knows it. IronPort sees something, it runs its heuristics, it actually creates a log. The log goes to the central syslog server. From central syslog server, it comes to Bro, and then gets digested into Bro. Doesn't matter what you do, it is still slower than what Bro already has. So how do you deal with that? So basically, use stable expire functions. So I would actually, like when I see an email, I would create an entry in a temporary table. I would expire it after 30 seconds. Expire function would actually, by that time, IronPort log actually has all the status from input framework. That expire function goes, queries the IronPort log, decides if it wants to take an action, generate an alert, or not generate an alert. So this is how you start tying things together. And I think I went from 101 to like this is level 400 probably, and I can see people's face, but here, look at this thing. I had a problem. This is the way you solve that particular problem. And it actually kind of helps you out to do things better inside Bro. So this is a high level overview where you can go, what you can do, how you can do things. So there are Bloom filters in Bro. Bloom filters are actually probabilistic data structure. I use them because we have 10 million IP addresses. Put them in table, now you need to buy more RAM. Put them in a Bloom filter, it's done. So you basically like just put things in Bloom filter. It's pretty straightforward. Event Bro init would initialize Bloom filter. You put all these things. These are crazy numbers. This would actually cause Amitai's gave me a script which actually calculates the size of Bloom filter and all these things based on what probabilities and how much is the membership. But basically, you literally say, add this IP address to the Bloom filter, then you do a lookup, and if lookup is true, then yeah, there is a head. So this is how I would use this like list of millions of IP addresses inside a Bloom filter rather than a table and then get things done. Similarly, So Bloom filter is not only used for IP addresses, it's also used for URLs. So I needed to track all the URLs in the email and see if they get clicked on or not. You have 60 million URLs in a day. How would you track them? Putting in set table doesn't work. Putting them in a Bloom filter, check against the Bloom filter, you know it's again, is it there, is it not there? You're done. So now there is a cuckoo filter coming up. So the problem with Bloom filter was that you cannot delete things inside Bloom filter. So I had to do like devise this entire another mechanism where I would create a set of whitelists. So you add something to Bloom filter, you cannot delete it, but you like now I have to delete something, I put that in the set, and then first I check against in the set. If it's in the set, fine. If it's not in the set, I go and check the Bloom filter. So it was like twisting arms, but there is a cuckoo filter. Any questions? I have no idea, I haven't used it yet, but Jan actually wrote this entire thing. He is an expert in this, bug him. So he is opaque of cardinality. This is again like another table, and the extent of the functionality, it gets pretty confusing, but the extent of functionality is that you have a table of address of opaque of cardinality, you define and initialize the structure, but the way it works is literally like you say, okay, So in new connection, you actually call this function, you add the IP address to this particular opaque of cardinality, and then on manager, you can go and then you, like all the, basically, the way this used to this works is that all the workers actually have this data structure. Then workers see all the new connection events. So the workers would actually keep adding an IP to this particular host of opaque of cardinality in the data structure. Now here is the complexity, and connection can be seen across different workers. So let's say, for example, IP 1.1.1.1. It was seen on worker 1, it was seen on worker 3, it was seen on worker 7. So now the problem is repeated count. But what you do is like all the workers report to the manager, manager actually does a merge, and merge would take care of all the repeat counts, and you actually would see that, yeah, this remote IP connected to 3 hosts and this. But this probabilistic data structure works more when the counts are higher, not lower. So like there might be 4 hosts and it might show you 3, but if there is like 10,000 hosts, it is gonna give you a pretty accurate approximate number. So how do I even start scripting? I overloaded everybody with so much information already, but how do I start scripting in Bro? So I would say go to try.bro, just paste code and it runs. Another one is in Bro control config, there is a variable called site policy scripts. So set that up as your home directory or whatever directory you have your policies in, and just run Bro on live traffic. Actually, I generally prefer the second one. So write all this cumbersome scripts and run on live traffic, it crashes, and then tell Bro team, I am complaining, but they think I am helping them out. So the third way is set up Bro path. Based on Bro path, you can actually run Bro exactly like Bro, and then dash R your PCAP, and then the script name, and basically run against a PCAP and get things going. So there are some different ways. So we are literally like Bro, my custom scripts, or you can do is Bro dash R, a PCAP, and my custom scripts. And then I generally put stuff in my test directory and just append it to the Bro path. Bro path now knows where to look for this script, because your script might actually be calling other scripts, like for example, HTTP analyzer. So the HTTP analyzer is sitting in base protocols. So, but this path would actually allow your script to go and find rest of the Bro package scripts too. So, but what is the basic structure of Bro scripts? Sorry to bother, but can somebody like flag me on time? Like 10 minutes remaining, I'm totally lost actually. 7? Okay, so the basic structure of Bro scripts is you tap on desired event. You need to find what event is interesting. You tap on that event, you find an appropriate data structure, you declare all these global local scopes, and then you identify your heuristic and what particular notice you want to generate. Then you go to like, is clusterization needed? And then how scaling works. Scaling is like, oh, I have 20 million IPs. I can't use a set or a table. I use Bloom filter or an opaque of cardinality or cuckoo filter or something like that. So this is generally a high level overview of how you would write a script. This is a sample script. This is to track web spiders. So somebody is just spidering through your web server. I said, okay, I'm gonna count how many 404 not found are seen. So basically, yeah, you create a table address of count, and then you say, okay, track 404 in HTTP reply. There is a code 404. If code is 404, you actually see if that IP address is in your table. If it is not, you actually initialize it, and then you add it, and then if it touch, there are 100 404 connections, you say, oh yeah, here is a notice. It's pretty straightforward, simple stuff, actually. But this is all wrong with it, actually. So the first thing is, I don't need a response IP. Why am I declaring that? Like, you generally are in habit of, oh, yeah, yeah, I might need it later. Let's declare it. No need to do it. If don't use it, don't declare it. Then I said, oh, code equals to 404. There's something wrong here. The deal wrong is, like, OK, not all HTTP codes are 404. There are a lot more 200 OKs than 404. So this condition is not true. It still goes further down on all the heuristics. You're wasting cycles. Then here is a bug which actually I learned in high school, off by one error. Like, you are, the count is already two here. You don't do that, right? So this is another one. So even though I declared default to zero, I'm just making another mistake here. Then this particular part is wrong, because even if the code is not 404, this code still keeps running. So if you have 20 million HTTP connections, if you have 20 million HTTP connections, you would still have 20 million no ops here. What's the point? So here is the right version to do this. Basically, I should have removed this. I did not. But yeah, if code is not 404 written, I don't care. If it is uninteresting, I don't care. Just return from here. If you do that, rest of the code never actually gets executed, never has to worry about. Initialize, it's a zero, and then go on, so forth. So basically, one of the basics of Bro scripting is eliminate uninteresting things. If you have a heuristic which only works on remote IP addresses, I'm going to do a membership test of checking if a source IP is actually in local nets. If a yes, I do not care, it's my local net, I'm going to return. Rest of the heuristics don't run. So this is kind of counterintuitive, but this totally makes sense. Like, if your things run on every event, you want to minimize unnecessary event calling or code executions. So there are Bro scripts which are basically, my fundamental use of Bro is actually to create attack-centric detection. Like, okay, remember ptrace kmod in HTTP URL? Attacker can use another exploit and they beat me. But I know that attacker is gonna download an exploit. So let me just quickly go through this. Here is this thing, an attack. Simple stuff where an attack actually scans a vulnerable system is found, you execute an exploit, in this case shell shock, and then download a malware, and then you do a misuse. The detection is like, yeah, I have a scan detection. You may or may not be able to find a vulnerable machine depending on how much you know about the system. If you have a detection for shell shock, you actually use that. There is a download of malware that can be a curl, wget, a URL, a DNS, so on and so forth, and then there could be a misuse. Misuse could be IRC session. Misuse lately has been Bitcoin mining. So, you know, there are all these different kinds. It used to be movies at one point, so it depends. So, but you actually take different actions. But the deal is, like, can you create a bro heuristic for each state? So even if the transition of an attacker from state second to third happens, and they beat you on it, you might be able to still figure out a notice on transition from state three to four. So that is generally how a bro script actually should be working. That you take an attack, you understand the attack, you define attack in different state, and then you worry about these transitions and see how all different ways these transitions can actually happen, and then you write heuristics for that. On a good day, your detection should light like a Christmas tree. So on a bad day, you have a few fuse bulbs, and at least one will light up. So, but why am I showing this? Because there was a shell shock thing in 2014, and then it's like, okay, we came up with, like, okay, there is an attempt, there is a hostile domain, because when there is an attempt, shell shock actually would do a curl, and then they would call this particular URL. This URL has a domain, so it's like, oh, yeah. Does bro, so basically, extract all the URLs. So you extract the URL, you extract the domain, see if there is a DNS lookup there, you do a correlation there. What's the hostile URI? Did a machine go there? If yes, then you generate a compromise alert. This is 2014. Why am I talking of this specific one? The reason is because it was applicable in 2018 with Apache Struss. Struss actually had one of the experts which was pretty much similar to Shellshock. There's all this jumbled HTTP request, but there is this still a wget in here. This happens, if this happens, there is a malware URL. So when I had to do the Struss 2 detection, I'm like, huh, this looks similar. I went to Shellshock, I did a find replace of Shellshock with Struss so that the notices are reasonably decent, and little modifications in regular expressions. But the reason I was able to do that was you actually write a script which actually is depicting an attack in different stages, and then you can do a attack-centric detection. So I think I'm already out of my time, right? So I have a bunch of other stuff, but I think I'm going to pass on all that. As I said, I did not know what I signed up for. Like, bro scripting 101 is a 4-hour topic. But I really wanted to do a tutorial where, like, people can see or at least get a little more familiar with how scripting works, how powerful this particular functionality is, how you can use what my ways of using bro scripting is. So if you have questions, definitely, like, actually I have like so many more slides. And this is first ever talk where I didn't finish it, but I don't want you to miss Johanna's talk. But this is basically the fundamental philosophy. A lot of people ask me this question, like, what bro can do for you? And it's like, no. Change it. What you want to do, and see if bro is a good tool for it. And generally it is. And like all these different things which I talked with scripting perspective should actually give you a convincing argument. If you have questions, send an email to security, you'll get a much prompter response. My email address too, and we use Zeek, you should too, so. Any questions? Yes.
So you're building all these data tables. How do you keep that data persistent between restarts?
No, right now we cannot do that. Okay. So there are certain things I have been doing, and there are certain things which you can do now. For example, I didn't talk about it, but Bro has a very solid Postgres plugin, where you can actually create this data structure in Bro and call the Postgres plugin, which would actually create equivalent table inside the Postgres database. And it's pretty much transparent. And the way the logging framework works is, like, you can say log to text file, log to JSON, you can say log to Postgres, and it literally goes and populates this Postgres table. So the way I would track these URLs in HTTP is basically I will take the URLs, dump them in the Postgres table, and then just create a Bloom filter. When Bro restarts, I repopulate the Bloom filter, and if there is a hit, I go to the Postgres, I actually do a query, get a response back, and that's the way I tie a URL with the very first email I got. But with the new broker, you have a data store, and that actually is a lot more promising. I I should admit, I haven't even gone to start using it, but that solves this problem of persistence. Any other questions? Well, thanks a lot for listening and bearing with my talk. So feel free to ask any questions later too. Thank you.